So, well, we have now have a kind of testing session. First story is by Sönke Hahn, who talks about generic programming.
Yeah, I'm Sönke Hahn. I'm a Haskell programmer, and this is the rough outline of the talk. So first, I'm going to start with the motivation, not only motivation for data type generic programming, but also motivation why I want to talk to you about this. And then we're going to look a bit at the details of how that is implemented, how that looks in code. There are always two sides to data type generic programming. One is how to use the generic functions, and the other one is how to write generic functions yourself. And we're going to look at that. And then there's going to be a comparison with reflection and object oriented languages, which I think is quite similar. And then I want to talk about possible applications of DGP. At the end, we will have some questions, but I also would like to encourage you to ask questions. Yeah, the source for the slides are different Haskell files. So the classical example for data type generic programming is serialization and deserialization. And I also want to quickly show you how that works. Probably most people are interested in the actual, but I quickly want to show you how that works in code. So here, for example, is that readable? Going to spend so much time in code. So this is a Haskell module, and what you see here is a very simple definition of an algebraic data type. It's called person. And then we have an example value that is Alice and has a name that is a string Alice. And what we can do now is that we can encode with a library called ASIN, we can encode this value into JSON by doing not much, just saying that we want. The other direction, deserialization, also works. So we have this example Bob encoded, which is just a byte string of JSON data. And then we can say decode Bob encoded. This will give us nothing because the compiler doesn't know what type we expect. Right? The byte string doesn't tell us what type it is. So we have to say that this So I wrote a library a few months ago that is called Set of Generics that tries to deviate a bit from this traditional use case of data type generic programming where you serialize stuff, but you serialize stuff. And there's also an example in here. So what you can do with that library is you can just say good CLI, and then you obtain a person, and then the library will, through generic programming, generate a command line interface for you. So in practice, that looks like this. You can say demo CLI, and then it will tell you, well, there's two flags, right? Like name and age, which are exactly two fields of the algebraic data type. And you will also get a help output, which will tell you what flags you have. And if you actually do it right, then it will be able to decode that value, like a value of your ADT from the command. And there was, I gave a short talk about this library some months ago, and there were a few questions after the talk that had me thinking, because like the first question was like, can you use this library to produce deconstructing functions for your algebraic data type? Right, like catamorphisms or something like that. And the answer is no, you can. This is a command line interface library. But of course you can use generic programming to do that. And there was another question, very similar. Can you use this library to generate UIs to construct values of your algebraic data type? The answer is again, like, no, not with this library, but with generic programming. So it felt like there was a lack of understanding of that data type generic programming is actually applicable in a far wider range than just these classical examples that ACE defines serialization. And I think this should be explored much more, and that's why. This is a quick, very partial overview of the generic libraries that we have. So we have this kind of older branch, something called Scrap Your Boilerplate, which is based on type of data. Unitest is another library that has a very similar approach. I'm not going to talk about that. A newer approach is based on GHC generics, which is a generic library that is kind of built into GHC. So GHC can generate classes, instances for your algebraic data types for this library. And then based on that library, you can have different generic libraries that are more convenient than the low level that the GHC provides. One of them is called Generic SOP, which is quite nice. In this talk, I'm going to use Generics EUT, which is a library that I wrote. The main design goal was that it should be simple to understand, simple to learn, just to give some context. Okay, so we've already seen it in the code how you use generic functions. Here's a quick recap. So in the slides, we're going to use this algebraic data type that actually has two constructors, user and anonymous. And one of them has two fields, the same fields as the other. And here again, we have the ASIN example, which says encode this user in JSON, and then we get this. And here's the other direction again, serialization, where you say, I have this JSON and I want to decode that. That makes sense so far? So, and that's actually the ultimate goal of generic programming, that using this is really, really straightforward. You just write down the data type, and then you say, like, well, then you do the magic, do the serialization, or whatever the library supports. This is another example that I think is interesting because it's more complex. So there is a library called Swagger2, which allows you to generically obtain parts of Swagger schemas. So Swagger is a description for the JSON and JSON APIs. And here you have to put in a proxy of a user because you don't have a value, right? Like you don't have a value of a user, you just have this type and you want to obtain a specification of that. And then two schema just generates a data type that is called Swagger, which is this it's called the part of the schema. And that one you can encode in JSON because everything in Swagger can be encoded in JSON, and then you print it out. This doesn't fit on the slide, but you can see here that you have a description of what constructor you have or what your type is called, and you have required fields name and age, and then it even gives you like bounds for your fields. So this is probably the maximum bound of integers. Yeah, so that's how you use generic functions. And to show you how to write generic functions, what I want to do as an example is to implement a function getConstructorName, that will take a value of type A and then give you a string that is the name of the constructor that was used to construct that value.
Yes. Before we go ahead, can you elaborate a little bit more on that function class?
Yes, I'm wondering if it makes sense to do it later. I hope I get back to that. I think it makes sense later. So in this case, we don't have a proxy, so we actually do have a value A of some ADT, and we want to obtain the constructor as a string. And of course, we need some class constraint on that A that we don't know yet. Generally, I think it's useful to think of generic programming in generally being able to perform three different kinds of things. One is accessing meta information, which is things like looking at the constructor names, for example, and looking at the names of the field, or also the name of the type, and also the types of the fields. The second and third are kind of inverse. The second is consuming, so generic functions can consume a value of your custom ADT and then do something. Classic example, of course, being serialization. And the third category is producing something, so they will produce a value of your ADT, given like by a string. So sometimes you have generic functions that only use one of these categories, but most of the times you have to somehow combine them. So even, for example, if you look at JSON serialization, you already need consuming and meta information because you need to know what the field names are, right? So you always have that information. And the consuming and producing both use something that we call an isomorphic generic representation of your data. And we're going to talk about that. So an isomorphic representation is something that might have a different type, but you can always translate from one type to the other. So for every value in this user data type, for example, you can assign a value in this isomorphic type where anonymous would map to nothing, and then user would map to a tuple of a string. It's not very straightforward, but this is probably the shortest isomorphic type that you can have. It's important that this works in both directions, right? Like you can translate every value of a user into a value of this type and back, and you always get out the same thing. There's, of course, for every type, there's lots of different isomorphic representations. So for example, this one would be one that would be slightly more straightforward, I think, because here the left would correspond to the user and the right would correspond to anonymous. And you kind of maintain the order of the constructors, which is kind of nice. So it's easier to understand. Generic EUT uses this generic representation, which is more complicated than this one, sadly, because for fields, it uses a right nested tuple construct. So this one's the first field, this one's the second field, and then you have an end marker that will always be here. And for constructors, for the choice between constructors, it uses a nested either structure where the following structure was in the right case. And it also uses kind of an end marker, which is void. So this one will be the first constructor, and this one will, if this one is left, this will be the second constructor. And of course, void is the uninhabited type. So right for this part is not a better choice, which is exactly what you want, right? Like, you don't have a constructor. And what generic EUT allows you to do with this type class, which is called HasEUT, is it allows you to map between the type of your custom ADT, your custom algebraic data type, and the generic representation type. And it also allows you to map between the values. So you do have this EUT function, which is a type-level function And this allows you to say, oh, I have a user, but then EUT user is this type, this that we've seen before, this either string int, either port. And the typecast also contains a function called 2EUT, which allows you to transform a value of the type user into a value of the type EUT user, which is equivalent to this. Are you familiar with the tilde for type equality?
What does EOT stand for again?
That's a good question. It stands for either of tuples. So so the isomorphic representation is always kind of like a layer of eithers for the different constructor choices, and then a layer in the constructor choices, a nested structure of tuples. So this is how HasEUT, how you can use HasEUT, for example, in a GHCI. This colon kind exclamation mark is kind of a way to talk GHCI into evaluating type level functions. So what it actually is you ask for a kind, and it gives you the kind, which is EUT user is the colon star, that's the kind, which doesn't interest us. But if you add the exclamation mark, it will also tell you the so-called normalized version of that type, which in this case is the isomorphic type that you see. And then if you now call 2EUT on user caller 3, you will get this left caller 3 thing. The left indicates that it's the first constructor, right? And if you do from UT right unit, then the right indicates that you get the second constructor. Well, in this case, not the first. So one question that usually comes up is like, why do we need these end markers? Couldn't we get away with just saying UT of user should be either string int, so here we just have a tuple of the two fields. But the question that arises is, what would then be the isomorphic representation of full string int? That would then have the same isomorphic representation, right? Because like if we only have one field, we put it here. So the point is, we can't if we use this and we don't have an end marker, we can't distinguish. We can't reliably identify which are the field types in our isomorphic representation, right? So if we have this convention that we have end markers, we can always reliably say, well, these are two constructors, and this is a field type, and this is a field type, and this has no fields.
So if you didn't use a tuple for the UT representation, you wouldn't need that one. If you use a specific data.
Although you will then probably also end up with a list-like structure that also has a marker. Right? I mean, this is like a design question of how you want to represent. Like the different generic libraries that use this differently. The GSC genetics, for example, uses trees. So the void end marker, yesterday I tried to find an example of how you can. Like a similar example where you run into problems if you omit the void end marker, but I wasn't able to figure one out if you use the field end marker. But I still think it's so much easier to reason about all this if you have an end marker, if this is something like a list-like structure. We're going to see that later, how you iterate over this either structure. But now we have to scroll back and look actually at the data type function, which is for the meta information. And I'm going to show you the header implementation for that. Yes. So here you can see the type class has UT, and then you have the type family UT, and then you have two UT. from E2. And then you have this function called data type, which gets a proxy of A and gives you a data type. And maybe now is a good point to explain why you need a proxy. So what this data type does is it gives you meta information about your type, right? So for example, the data type name. And if you want to know the data type name, you don't need the value of that type, right? You just need to know the type somehow. So you need a way to reference the type without actually having a value, right? And the proxy A is just a very simple data type that says, well, I am polymorphic on some type, but I don't have a field of that type. Yeah.
Don't really want to distract us about the design, but in this particular case, why don't you phantom tag the data type? Data type. Why don't you just say data type A and not use the A anywhere, and then you avoid the need for a proxy?
Yeah, that's a good idea. Yeah, so with proxies, it's always, you could also, it doesn't matter whether it's an input parameter or an output parameter or a type parameter or some type that you have, because you only need to pin down the type and it's going to use no reference. Does that make sense?
I mean, what you said makes sense. He's optimistic, but maybe more advanced than
that. Yeah, that might actually be a point that this one is a pattern that everyone already knows. Not everyone, but that more people already know and understand.
I'm not sure. Had you explained it the other way, I'm sure. I mean, this is now less understandable because it's not coming from you.
Sure. So the data type that you can obtain for every type that has a key instance is actually it doesn't have any type information about your type at the type level anymore, about your ADT, but it only gives you like strings and the number of constructors and the number of fields and that. So it's a very straightforward data structure where you just have the type name and then you have a list of constructors. And then every constructor has a name and has fields, and every field is either a list of field selectors, or you have a constructor that doesn't have selectors but doesn't have fields, and then you just get the number of fields, because if you don't have type information, that's all you can do. Or you have no fields. So this is how the output of data type looks for our example data type. So we pass in the proxy for a user, and then we get this long line that you can see here in a formatted way. So here you can see what the data is. The name is user, you have two constructors, one's called user, anonymous, and one contains the name age, the other one has So now we want to actually use this to build this function that takes an A of our data type and gives us the constructor name. And what we're going to start with is to write the function that deals with the isomorphic representation, right? So, and we need to use a type class for this because the isomorphic representation is not one single pin-down type, right? It obviously is different for different ADTs, but also when you iterate through it, it's a different type, right? So you need to use a type class. So you say, well, EUT is a type for which I can obtain the constructor name. And the first argument that we're passing in is the list of constructors that we want to consider, that we have to obtain with data type. And then the second argument is our isomorphic representation. And then what we return is the and now we need to write instances for the different possible scenarios that our isomorphic representation can have. So the first instance is the one where we iterate over a constructor. So the instance is written for either x, xs, so x would be the for example, the first constructor, the first iteration, and xs would be, you know, all the rest, like all the other items. And then we are saying, well, if the value is left, then we know this is the constructor that we're looking for. If the value is right, then we know we have this either type in here that encodes, you know, the rest of the constructors. And we just have to take out the first constructor name and call this recursive. Of course, we can make errors here, like if we forget to do that, then we will mess up, so we don't have type safety here, which other libraries provide. And of course, we just make a compiler dot warnings. We add this empty case where we say, like, well, we could end up with an empty list, but then we have made something wrong. The next instance that we're going to write is kind of for the end marker, and it doesn't really make that much sense, but we have to write it to make the compiler happy. And if we look, I repeated the signature of the method so that we can see what is actually going on. So what we see here is that we will get the void data type, which is uninhabited. So we can actually, as a type, already see that this function, you know, if someone doesn't hand us a button, then this function will never be called. So we have to write on the instance to make the compiler accept our isomorphic representations, but this code will never be called. Well, we already looked at the data type declaration. So this is now how we finally implement the get constructor name function where we tie them together. So here we just say, well, if we have an A and A has an EOT instance, and we also have an EOT constructor name instance, which is the class we just wrote, for our isomorphic representation, which is EOTA, then we can actually implement this function and just call EOT constructor name, and then the first argument just has to be a list of all constructors, and we can easily obtain that through the data type. So we just say we want to get the data type, we have to hand the proxy of A, we have to reference A here, so that's why we need the for all over there, so that this one actually be the first one, the same A. And then we just extract all constructors, and then all our constructors we map. The second argument is just the isomorphic representation of the value. This is here, you can see that so if we say get constructor name of user something, we will get a string that contains the name of the constructor user. And if you set up anonymous, then any questions to this? This is all that I'm going to say about how to use this technical level.
I'm actually interested in what happens in data type, the function data type.
What happens in there?
Yes. How does it hook into, how does it find all the information it needs?
So the implementation of HasEOT, you can automatically derive that as both as a user of generic libraries and also as a user of, if you want to write generic libraries. Right? It's based on a library called generics deriving, right? Which is baked into GHC. So GHC can actually magically create an instance for this underlying class, which is called GHC generics generic, and this also contains, in a very similar fashion, with a different design for how to represent the metadata, but it also contains all the strings at the value level for. It's actually quite nice that this layer is built into GHC, but it's designed in a way that, like explicitly meant to have other libraries built on that. And yeah, I think it's just very similar to how show is generated. It's just a compiler. Okay, any other questions? So I want to compare data type generic program with reflection because it's not the same, but in my mind it really solves more or less the same use cases that you have. So I think like whenever I think of I want to have reflection in Haskell, I think like, oh, but this can be done. So reflection, this is the definition from Wikipedia, is the ability of programs to look at their types and their structure at runtime. Right? So for example, in Java, you can ask an object, what is your class? And then you can get some class object. You can ask that class, what is your name? You can ask that class, what are your methods? You can ask what are your fields, and then we'll give you this fields, and you can ask every field what's your type, and then you can also dynamically call methods and so on and so forth. So I think, here I'm saying again that in my mind these solve very similar problems. But reflection happens at runtime, right? So the big difference to data generic programming is that at least part of it happens at compile time. And there's also a few things that you gain from that. So, for example, you can't statically guarantee certain things about your ADTs at compile time if you want to use them in generic functions. For example, if you have an ORM library, you can actually write generic functions that will statically fail if one of the field types or the type that you want to write into the database is not mappable to a type. To a field type of your database. Or you can ensure that your ADT only has one constructor, which is very often what you want to ensure both for databases and also for serialization. Because lots of serialization problems don't have a good notion of some types so you want to support one. There's also a bunch of other situations where I would think that reflection and DGP are very different and allow different things to do different things. Most of these things are just due to the nature of the language that they're used in. So in Haskell, for example, we don't have nullable types, but in lots of object-oriented languages, we do have nullable types. And of course, this poses challenges to, for example, deserialization, right? Like, so for example, if you want to parse a JSON object, but you operate on the assumption that you can just omit fields and then they will be set to null in a Java object. Well, then you can parse like the empty object to every Java object, which is probably not really what you want. So in Haskell, you don't have nullable types. You have to wrap everything in maybe, and then generic programming languages can also make use of that and say like, well, if this field is in a maybe, then I create a parser that allows to print the field. But if not, then it has to be a test. Another problem, the third point, dynamic typing. Right? If, for example, in a language like Python, you do have reflection, and it's also used very often. But of course, if your normal language has like concepts where you can just add fields in your constructor, and there's no way of statically looking at a class and saying like, oh, this class has these fields, right? So you just add it at runtime. And this, for example, makes it very difficult to generate database schemas. So there are workarounds. So you have like DSLs in Python that where you actually declare a field with a library function. But then you kind of already are restricted in what your class can do by this library. And And the nice thing about DGP and Haskell is that whatever generic libraries you use, they will not affect your runtime representation of your values. Like you can easily combine all kinds of generic programming approaches, and they won't interfere with each other because the core, the runtime representation of the values is exactly the same. There's also a point to be made about sometimes and subtypes, but I think that's the same point. Another thing that Haskell does allow that I haven't seen in any other languages is type level computations, and you can also do that, combine them with generic programs. So for example, you could imagine a generic library that where the type of something that you obtain depends on, I don't know, how many fields your constructor has. I haven't really come up with a very, very compelling use case, but I'm sure this will be useful at some point. One example that I don't know how relevant is. One example is that you could imagine a database library that allows you to generate schemas, where you can then save your values of your type. And then for everything that has a maybe, it creates an out-of-the-box constraint and allows the database field to be null. But for everything else, it forces you to give a default value. And then the schema generation would actually have dynamically many parameters that have to fill into to supply the default value. But it's a bit of a contrived example. But I'm sure this will be useful. Yes. So this is actually, I guess, the most important slide in my mind. Because what I want to achieve is that you leave this talk and think that, oh, Datatype Generic Programming can do lots and lots of things, and there are so many interesting applications where you can do that. It's not really that hard to do it. So this is just a list of things that we start with more traditional things that are also quite maturely supported by libraries on package. For example, binary serialization is, I think, the first generic class that I have seen. And then serializing to JSON is picked up in ASIN, which is also very mature already. You could imagine generating default values, right? So that you just say, well, I have this data type, and once you know default values for all the fields for the first constructor, you can just use the first constructor and create a default value. Might be useful for lots of things. Very similar is generating arbitrary test data. This is also being worked on a great chapter. So the idea is that you just write on an ADT and then you say, well, just generate random values of this ADT for testing purposes. Another example that I already mentioned a few times is database schema generation. And I haven't seen that in a library, but you could perfectly well imagine that you just say, here's a proxy of my ADT, and then it gives you an SQL statement that you can just send to the database and then save. In that table. Database insert, of course, that one already exists, I believe, at least for Postgres. Command line interfaces is what I've shown in the beginning. Traversals, which, so you could imagine a generic program that allows you to take a random, take an arbitrary ADT, a value of ADT, and then add a number to every integer that's in there. This is also like one of the primary use cases for scrambling boilerplate approach, but this is also possible with this. And yeah, the list goes on. I mean, like you can generate HTML forms that allow you to create values of the ADT. You can imagine a library that routes HTTP requests based on the names of the labels of your type. I think that also exists. There's lots of things. Of course, the parsing configuration files, reading the values from your environment variables. So, as a closing statement, I think of DGP as like the reflection for Haskell. Whenever you would use reflection in another language, just turn to DGP. It does support serialization. Serialization is very mature. arbitrary, like the more traditional use cases of PGP, but it also has many other applications. And the whole area, to me, seems very much unexplored. And I think that generic programming is not that complicated. I mean, it's not the most trivial thing that you can do in Haskell, but it's also not that complicated. And it's a lot of fun. So I'd like you, of course, to draw the conclusion that we're going to talk now about generic programming. Here are a bunch of links to libraries and also to these slides. And thanks very much for your like a way to say, I want a JSON instance, but please just use the generic implementation, while still maintaining the possibility of saying, like, I need a completely different JSON format because I'm different from some kind of service that needs a completely different format, and I want to write my instance in that. That might also be the need for to do this for performance reasons.
Underlying representation as Sönke was saying, so it's all building on what GHC generates underneath, and GHC currently doesn't generate generic representations for GHCs. It's not entirely impossible that it might do at some point in the future, but it is surprisingly tricky to do so.
How does it compare to
I lost the word. But basically, macros in other languages. So I mean, like, I'm not a full-time Haskell programmer. I just debuted it. But like, for example, in Scala, I would do most of this stuff with macros. They're gonna be ugly because I'm gonna work directly with a syntax tree. But I can still do it on compile time. So how what is the difference between this approach and macros?
In Haskell, it's called template Haskell, and there are quite mature solutions for deriving instances for type classes with template Haskell. That also works. And of course, if the macros are implemented good, then that's also fine. I personally like this approach much better because it's part of the real language. I mean, a template with macros, you can do anything, right? And you could basically just read in a JSON representation of your data type and then just generate it.
So this would be like higher abstraction level, I guess. So,
I think you also get much more safety, right? I have never used the deriving template Haskell solution. I've never written one, but with this implementation, you also it's also quite straightforward to come up with the generic functions when you have this isomorphic representation, right? But if you use template Haskell, then you have to deal with ASTs of your data type, and then perform a translation and generate some code that is correct in every case. I think it's much easier to not make mistakes if you use this as which is part of the language.
Yeah, I just wanted to say, I mean, with template Haskell, you're always only checking the generated instances. You're type checking the generated instances. You're never checking that under all circumstances your recipe will generate the type of instance. You're hoping that. But with this one, you actually do. I mean, with this one, you kind of have the guarantee that the recipe itself is type correct. It will always produce type correct instances. So, yeah. But that's.
Maybe here there might also be a performance issue. I don't know how fast serialization is derived. I mean, with double math, you just generate data code, so it should be quite as fast as standard code. With standard deriving, you always have another level at runtime. But standard has also a problem that compiling your program takes much, much more time than.
I'm not a Haskell programmer, so some of this is not so familiar with me, but it seems that you're jumping through a lot of hoops to get some metadata about these abstract data types, algebraic data types, that you probably wouldn't if these were plain old iconic, right? Because you, if they were plain old iconic. So the language represented was something you could represent in data, like in a list. For instance, there's a high number like what or Julia, these are the high five languages.
So where you have all the information at the right hand representation.
Right, so you could just dereference this structure you have at the top of this data user thing. This would be another data structure in the language, and then you could just say, I want this value inside there. I mean, to me, it sounded like you were going through a lot of, okay, we're doing this meta thing where we have to pass a proxy of the type, and then from that, then you go, either it's this value, and if it has this value, then it's this thing. I mean, it sounds like you're jumping through a lot of hoops for what you could just get from somewhere, but I'm not sure how this relates to exactly Haskell, or whether or not that would be type save at all, but I have the feeling that you could do the type save.
I don't think you could. So the thing is that in Haskell, this is more problematic because you do need the information about your ADTs at compile time. And it doesn't exist per se at runtime. So yes, you do have to jump through a lot of hoops to do that. And it's also not a coincidence that data type generic programming is younger than reflection. And of course that's not good, right? Like it would be better if it were easier. But at the same time, from these properties that you have statically, all your field types, for example, you also do get some different properties of what data type generic programming can be.
Do you mean that this way you don't need to hang around for all this data at runtime that you previously could just be discarding from that?
Yes.
I think it's interesting discussion, but that's great.